Good morning, and as you can see, we're going to have a little bit different opening to our musical worship this morning that we typically do. What you see is our living, breathing, walking advertisement for the new building we're building out there. These are the students that are part of our Sunday school ministry, and Chris McDowell and Jill Aguiar faithfully teach them not only songs that they sing for us to listen to and meditate on scriptural truth, but each week they are faithful to continue to add to the musical knowledge songs that are written for congregations to sing. And so they're going to sing one where we sit and listen, and then they're going to sing a second song where we're going to have the whole congregation join with them in singing. But thank you, Jill, Chris, Joanna, and students for ministering to us this morning. Let's stand together. Let's continue to sing of this glorious salvation, especially as Paul writes of it in the opening verses of Ephesians chapter 1. Come together and let's praise and glorify our great God. Please remain standing as we hear from this gracious God through the reading of his word, led this morning by one of our elders, Pastor Kevin Wong.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm 96. Psalm 96, I invite you to follow along in your own copy of God's word, Psalm 96. Really, what we've just sung in our song of praise, the psalmist commands here, verse 1, sing to the Lord a new song, sing to the Lord all the earth, sing to the Lord, bless his name, proclaim good tidings of his salvation from day to day, tell of his glory among the nations, his wonderful deeds among all the peoples, for great is the Lord. And greatly to be praised, he is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the peoples are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him, strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in holy attire. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Indeed, the world is firmly established. It will not be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar and all it contains. Let the field exult and all that is in it. Then all the trees of the forest will sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming. For he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and his peoples in his faithfulness. You may be seated as we pray this morning. Oh, Father, how we are reminded, particularly even by this psalm, that you deserve our praise. Lord, we come this morning to this place because you are worthy of our worship. Lord, that is our heart. That is the declaration of your people, even in the very fact that we gather here today. Lord, our desire is to see you magnified for who you are. You are God, you alone, you the one who made heavens and earth. You, the one who created all that we see, the sea, the depths, and all the things in it, the trees, the land, the dry ground, the sky, the heavens, the angels. Indeed, we ourselves have been fashioned by your very word. Lord, and this is what, as we've just read, separates you. One of the reasons, just one reason why you alone are God, and every other thing that man would turn to is an idol. Lord, forgive us for worshiping false deities practically and sometimes even verbally and visually by our lives. Lord, we come this morning seeking to reaffirm together that there is one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And not only are you worthy of our praise because you are creator, but even as we've just sung from Ephesians chapter 1, to you alone belong glory and honor and praise for our salvation. You are the God who saves. That you have predestined us before the foundation of the world, and that you sent your Son to accomplish that salvation and that redemption, and that you seal us by your Holy Spirit. Father, all of this is your work from beginning to end, just like creation was. And so we praise you for it. We bless your name because of it. Father, we pray now that you'd be honored, that you would receive what is due your holy name in our service, from our praying to our preaching, to our hearing, to our fellowship, to our giving, and now as we, in our singing, we ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Even for those of us who have been redeemed by God's glorious grace, made alive through the work of the Holy Spirit, every time we come to God's word in any form, we need the Spirit's work to illuminate its truths, not just to merely intellectually understand, but to, by faith, believe it, and then to apply it and allow it to change our lives. And one such song that allows us to pray that is Holy Spirit, living breath of God, asking the third person of the Trinity to take what's preached and shape and fashion our lives by it. So as a church family, would you please stand and pray this together in song? Holy Spirit, living breath of God. Father, we ask this dependent on your grace and yet expectant of your grace. Would you be so kind as to answer this and many other requests according to your will and through the work of the Spirit in the name of Christ. Amen. Please be seated.
It is the sermon today that prompted me this past week to think about the idea of mistaken identity, and I read an example of that in an internet article about something that happened 2007, even a little later. There was this consumer electronics retailer named Tweeter, not Twitter, but Tweeter, that filed for bankruptcy in 2007. And after they did that, then the company suddenly saw their stock jump up as much as 1,400% because Twitter announced their intentions to go public. So apparently people had trouble differentiating between even the symbols for the two companies, Tweeter and Twitter, because even the symbols looked alike, so people suddenly began investing in the wrong company, Tweeter. But then I realized I actually have an example of mistaken identity myself, something I was involved in recently. It's related to a phone call that I had with a pastor in another state. It started with this. I was given an email of the name of a pastor who had called asking for me and left a voicemail, and that email was passed on to me. This pastor wanted me to call him back because he wanted to invite me to come speak at a conference at their church. I did return the call. The problem is I only glanced at that email peripherally at the name, and I misread it, and I got it in my head that I was calling a particular pastor in Arizona that I know. Interestingly, the names of the pastor on the email who did call and the one that I was calling, their first names are the same. Their last name looks the same, starts with the same letter, is about the same in length, and when you look at it peripherally, yeah, that's what happened, at least when you're as old as I am. So I call him back, thinking I'm talking to my friend. And it was a great phone call. We got caught up. I asked him how his church was doing. I asked him how his family was doing. And what's interesting is all the answers fit the guy that I thought I was talking to. So when the point came that he invited me to come and speak at a conference at his church this summer, I was thrilled and said, well, of course, it'd be a privilege to come and do that. We talked for about 10 more minutes about that event, and as the conversation started to wind down, I just threw this out. I said, by the way, my wife Pam is so excited that she's coming to your church to speak at your women's conference, which she was, at the church I thought I was talking to. And the pastor responded with some confusion. It's like, wow, he said, I wasn't aware of that. Of course, I'm thinking, man, you need to get a handle on your ministry. I mean, you don't even know who's coming to speak, you know? But I also had this thought that I need to pull out of that conversation. Something's not right. So I dropped that discussion. I said, never mind. I'm sure I'm just confused about something. We finished the phone call, and when it was over, I realized that I was speaking at a conference, and I didn't know where it was or anything. And so I assumed the phone number was a cell phone, and so I texted him and just said, hey, it was great catching up with you. Thanks for inviting me. I texted him something like this. Hey, thanks for the invite. Tell me again the exact address of the church. That was a way to get some information out of him, you know. And he did. He texted back and told me. Of course, I went on their website and did confirm it was a totally different church in a totally different state. But I'm going there to speak. a case of mistaken identity. And obviously, both of those examples are low-level examples. They don't really matter in the eternal scheme of things. However, today we're going to look at what is a much more serious case of mistaken identity that's found in John chapter 12. It's related to one of the most dramatic events of Jesus' earthly life, what is commonly called the triumphant entry or the triumphal entry. That's the occasion when Jesus was publicly entering the city of Jerusalem, and he did it to the fervent praise of all the people just a few days before the cross. It's an event that's recorded in all four Gospels, by the way, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but nevertheless, it's been misunderstood by many. And one reason is that in so many previous situations when there were crowds clamoring for Jesus, and especially when there were crowds that posed a danger to Jesus in some way, Jesus usually withdrew from the people. There's an example of that several places in the gospel. One is Matthew 12, verses 14 and 15. It says the Pharisees conspired against him as to how they might destroy him. Jesus, aware of this, withdrew from there. He got away. John 7, verse 1, he was unwilling to walk in Judea because the Jews in general were seeking to kill him. There was another occasion where the hostile Jews had picked up stones to throw at him, and it says in John 8, 59, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, got away. There was the occasion later in John 11, which is right before the chapter we're studying today. John 11, Jesus was in the nearby town of Bethany. It was just to the east of the Mount of Olives. It was less than 2 miles away from Jerusalem. He had gone there, and that's where he healed Lazarus. But after healing Lazarus in nearby Bethany, Jesus chose to escape north. He went about 12 miles to the north of Jerusalem to avoid the hostility of the religious leaders. It says in John 11, 54, Jesus no longer continued to walk publicly among the Jews. No longer going to be in the public setting, but went away from there to the country near the wilderness. But now he is intentionally and publicly entering the city of Jerusalem in the midst of all the crowds. What's different now? Well, now was the time for Jesus to officially proclaim to Israel that, yes, he is their king. He is the Messiah, the Son of God, all in accordance with what the Old Testament had prophesied about him, and to do it now in the most public way possible. But here's what's important. He was proclaiming to be the king, but was not proclaiming that he was ascending to some sort of secular political throne, earthly throne. Instead, the time had come for his death upon the cross to pay for the sins of his people. So in his public entry, Jesus was actually intentionally setting in motion all the chain of events that would lead quickly to his death, and just a few days later, because this entry, as we'll see, was prodding the Jewish leaders eventually to act according to all the plans, the wicked plans they had to get rid of Jesus. And yet, this is all happening according to the will of God, and it was happening at the exact time foreordained by God. So turn with me to this account, the triumphant entry, John 12:12-19. We're pausing our study, obviously, of 1 Thessalonians for a couple of Sundays. This is a biblical record of a very serious case of mistaken identity. Now, we're going to walk through the scene together. I'll make some comments, but we are going to divide up this scene according to the various people and even groups of people that are involved in it. Here's number one. Let's note together the gathering pilgrims, verse 12. On the next day, the large crowd who had come to the feast, when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, took the branches of the palm trees and went out to meet him. The next day gives us a time reference there. It's referring to Sunday. It's Sunday of crucifixion week. And the feast mentioned would therefore be the feast of Passover. It was one of three yearly feasts that Jews were expected to attend in Jerusalem. You had Pentecost, Feast of Tabernacles, Passover. Passover is the one we're likely most familiar with. That's the one that was a special remembrance of God's deliverance of the people of Israel out of Egypt, the Exodus. It says there was a large crowd here for that. That's referring to all the pilgrims, mostly made up of pilgrims. By that I mean people who have traveled into the city from other towns, other cities, elsewhere in the region, far away perhaps, all converging on the town of Jerusalem. Normally, the population of Jerusalem throughout the year was around, at that time of history, was around 100,000 people. But once a year, especially during Passover, that number would swell, sort of like Furniture Week, you know, around here in High Point, you know. It would swell anywhere from 500,000 to 1,000,000 people, all crammed in the city. Jesus was going to Jerusalem, would observe Passover. He's arrived now in our story. He's arrived at the edge of Jerusalem. He has come from nearby Bethany. That's where he raised Lazarus from the dead. News of Jesus' approach was spreading. Jesus is coming. Many of these pilgrims wanted to see him. So they gathered on the road leading into Jerusalem, and it says in our text that they even had palm branches. What's the significance there? Why did they bring palm branches? Palm branches in the Old Testament are not associated with the celebration of Passover. Something else is going on. Well, it's what palm branches had come to represent. In the secular world at that time in history, the Greco-Roman world in their history, palm branches had become a symbol of victory, primarily military victory and conquest and kingship. To the Jews, palm branches had come to be a nationalistic symbol for them. Therefore, at Jesus' entrance to Jerusalem, the people were then waving all those palm branches, and you can get a feel for the scene there. It was in an atmosphere of great fervor and emotion and excitement and zeal, waving palm branches to point to something political. Their nationalistic hopes that Jesus was indeed the Messiah. He had finally arrived to liberate them from the rule of the Romans and to set up his messianic kingdom. The Old Testament had prophesied and is prophesying still that the Messiah will set up a messianic kingdom. That hasn't happened yet, but he will. They thought this was it. Commentator William Barclay, I think, has a great thought. He writes that the Jews were looking on him as the conqueror. To them, it must have been only a matter of time until the trumpets rang out and the call to arms sounded and the Jewish nation swept to its long-delayed victory over Rome and even over the world. Now, we have discussed this before in sermons in the past, especially when we went through the Gospel of John, that the common view amongst the Jews of that day was what I'm talking about, that Messiah would be a political, military leader, a liberator. An example is seen in John 6, 14 to 15. Therefore, when the people saw the sign, the miracle, which he had performed, they said, "This is truly the prophet who has come into the world." So Jesus, perceiving that they were intending to come and take him by force, now it's not a danger situation like those others I read. He understood what they were after. They wanted to make him king. For that reason, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself alone. Now, I mentioned that this account of the triumphant entries in all four Gospels, just for a moment, let's look at Mark's version of it. He adds some of the details that John chose to leave out. He adds that the people did one more thing to honor this, their hopeful political Messiah. It says in Mark 11, verse 8, many spread their coats in the road. Spreading garments in someone's path, that meant something. That was a token of tribute, but always reserved for royalty. So this act further expressed the crowd's belief that Jesus was their king. And back to John. John tells us that they were also shouting something, verse 13 of chapter 12. Waving palm branches, we know from Mark, they're laying coats down the road. They also began to shout, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." As I've said before, when you see capital letters like that in a verse in the New Testament, it's a way to designate that that's a quotation from the Old Testament. At least part of it is. And this is from a section of Psalms, actually. Psalms 113 to 118 is called the Hallel. These were the psalms that were sung each morning, sung by the temple choir during the various Jewish festivals and feasts. In particular, this is a quote from Psalm 118, verse 26. That term, Hosanna, it's a Hebrew term that literally means give us salvation now, bring salvation now. But over time, it just began to be a term of acclamation, a term of praise. But the next part of the verse is interesting. It starts with, "Blessed is he." In the original context of the Hallel Psalm, Psalm 118, in that context, that phrase, "Blessed is he," is referring to pilgrims who would go to Jerusalem for the feast. It's a way to pronounce a blessing or confer a blessing on the pilgrims. But later on, rabbinic writings and sources interpreted the psalm differently as that referring to the Messiah. He who comes is the Messiah. And so you need to know that because that's how the crowd in Jerusalem meant it that day. Blessed is he, our King, our Messiah. One more thing I should point out is that the ending phrase, "even the King of Israel," that's not in capital letters because it's not found in Psalm 118. It seems to have been added by the people. And that addition confirms how they were using Psalm 118. Now, as I noted, in the past, the Lord had refused to be viewed that way as a political king and a military conqueror, but here he is entering Jerusalem and he's not speaking up, saying anything against it. He's not refusing their praise. From their perspective, that would have just added to their excitement. Their thinking was, well, finally, Jesus is accepting the role that they wanted him to take. The gathering pilgrims. That brings us to the second character here. Number two, the humble king. Jesus' own understanding of himself and his mission was manifested even in the choice of the animal to ride on when he entered the city. Verse 14, Jesus, finding a young donkey, sat on it, as it is written, "Fear not, daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt." Now that term, daughter of Zion, initially was a way to refer to Jerusalem and the people that lived in Jerusalem, but over time it became a designation for the entire nation of Israel. But let's discuss donkeys for a moment. I told the elders this morning in prayer time, I'm preaching on donkeys today. And I also told them that I have to be careful about it because I say it wrong. Always have. My wife, after we got married 47 years ago, began to try to teach me English and help me. But I grew up saying donkey. They're donkeys. And she would say, "You hick, why do you say donkey? It's donkey." I still have trouble with it. Donkey. So let's talk about donkeys for a moment. They are mentioned in the Old Testament. We find them mentioned. By the time of Jesus, though, this animal was associated with two primary ideas, humility and peace. And that's in contrast, that's important because that's in contrast to what a war horse would have symbolized. I mean, why wouldn't he ride in on a great horse? The war horse symbolized power, might. Jesus chose a donkey. Again, Mark adds some more information. Let's look at that, of how they came to find the donkey. Mark 11, as they approached Jerusalem, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village opposite you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there on which no one yet has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' you say, 'The Lord has need of it,' and immediately he will send it back here." They went away, found a colt tied at the door, outside in the street, and they untied it. They brought it to Jesus. God in his providence was handling all of that, orchestrating all of that, this donkey that was ready for Jesus to use. Why choose a donkey, though? This is fulfillment of prophetic imagery. We find it in Zechariah 9, verse 9, this imagery, prophecy of a king coming in humility and peace. It says, "Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout in triumph, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and endowed with salvation. Humble, mounted on a donkey, even on a colt, the foal of a donkey." Jesus was fulfilling prophecy. And in doing that, he's giving this sharp contrast to the idea then of a political leader, a political Messiah. He's not riding on a magnificent horse. I mean, what would that have done? Oh, that would have stirred up the frenzy of the crowd even more. Our great leader, look at him. No, he chose to present himself as a king who comes in peace, gentle, humble, riding on a donkey. You see, Jesus knew what was going on. He knew the people's attitude toward him was superficial, that they had designed their own definition of him. And Luke adds something that's interesting. He lets us know that as the city came in more into view, in other words, they're going down the road and getting closer to the city with all the people and shouting and waving palm branches and laying their coats down and all of that, he can see the city at some point, and he stopped and did this, Luke 19, when he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city and he wept over it. So when Jesus entered Jerusalem that day, the crowd that was waving palm branches and proclaiming Hosanna, all of that was based on a colossal case of mistaken identity. But you know, it's not uncommon today for people to think wrongly about Palm Sunday. That's the Sunday that we have arrived at today. You'll find in the news sometimes pictures of groups celebrating it by doing what? Waving palms, shouting, reenacting what the crowd did as if that was a good thing. Instead, what we should really do is mourn on Palm Sunday. Because a celebratory observance is missing the point of what his mission was, his messianic calling, his messianic mission. He came not as a political leader, but to die for spiritual issues, people's spiritual problem, and that is their sin. The humble king. Third, the bewildered disciples. We're not surprised that they're bewildered. They usually were. Verse 16, these things his disciples did not understand at first. Keep in mind, you know, who's writing this? John. He's one of the disciples. He's including himself in this ignorance. But the ignorance makes no sense. Jesus had taught them all along what was going to happen. In fact, he had clearly declared to them what would happen even on the brink of his entry. We find this in Matthew chapter 20. This is what he said to his disciples. Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death and will hand him over to the Gentiles to mock and scourge and crucify him, and on the third day he will be raised up. Huh? Despite all of Jesus' clear statements, really all along the way, the disciples were puzzled of all that was going on with this triumphal entry. Just as they were puzzled by the cross. Even after the death and after being raised from the grave, they were still thinking, though, that, okay, now he'll be a political conqueror. Remember what happened in Acts chapter 1, verse 6. This is what they said to Jesus. This is after the death, after the resurrection. They said, well, Lord, so is it at this time that you're going to have your kingdom? This time is when you're going to restore the kingdom of Israel? Still didn't get it. But later they did. Verse 16 goes on. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things were written of him, and that they had done these things to him. In other words, after he ascended to heaven, as John puts it here, when Jesus was glorified, what happened? Follow Acts chapter 2, the day of Pentecost came, and the pouring out of the Holy Spirit, the birth of the church. The Holy Spirit came and cleared up all their bewilderment. And Jesus had told them that would happen in John chapter 14. The Spirit was coming. The Holy Spirit will teach you all things. He'll bring to your remembrance all that I said to you. John 16, when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. And the Spirit did that. So after Pentecost, the Spirit of God did indeed enlighten these men so that they truly understood Jesus' ministry, his calling, all of that. But then John goes on in verse 17 and mentions another group, a smaller group. We can summarize this group by just calling them the local residents. Those who were not traveling in as pilgrims from great distances, more those who were in the little suburbs around like Bethany and in the city itself. So the people, verse 17 says, who were with him when he called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead, continue to testify about him. These are the people that lived in nearby Bethany, less than 2 miles away to the east, plus the people in Jerusalem that had gone out to Bethany when he raised Lazarus from the dead. They saw that, and so these are the people that continued to publicize that great miracle, and that aroused the curiosity of many more in the city. So verse 18, for this reason, also the people went and met him. The local people, because they heard that he had performed that sign of raising Lazarus from the dead. So think about all this for a moment. This scene was explosive. If Jesus had been a political conqueror and liberator, this was the perfect moment. He could have begun an armed revolt right then and there. And there was another group of people who were thinking that. Number five, the religious leaders. The Pharisees. They're observing all this fervor and very concerned about it. And they're trying to figure out what to do. I mean, they thought all along the way to arrest Jesus, and it never worked out. Now they're thinking, should we arrest him now? I mean, it's getting out of hand. The excitement level is high, but that posed a problem. If they arrest him now, it'll be a huge scene, creating even more problems for them. So for the moment, all they could do was just be in dismay of what was going on, chafing under all this popularity that Jesus had, exasperated, and with their exasperation growing, what they did was just begun to lash out at one another. Verse 19, so the Pharisees said to one another, you see that you're not doing any good. In other words, the situation is spiraling dangerously out of control. They can't silence Jesus, so they just start blaming one another. But it's the next statement that's the most interesting. Look, the world has gone after him. Now the Pharisees, they're just using that word as hyperbole to say all these people, everyone in Jerusalem and all the pilgrims that have come in. But we know in the Gospel of John, John frequently inserts the word world into the accounts. And in John, he uses it commonly to refer to people everywhere without distinction. No distinction based on ethnicity, social distinction, racial distinction, so forth. Yet, who are all the same in one sense, lost. In John 3:16, that's what it means there. For God so loved the world. That's not a statement about God loving individual people. It's a statement about love of the lost world of mankind without distinction. It didn't matter about ethnicity. They all have the same problem. They're lost. So this statement has a double meaning intentionally by John. He inserts things like this in his gospel. It's an exaggeration on the part of the Pharisees. We get what they mean. But it, at the same time, is this ironic prophecy about something that was going to come. And that is the preaching of the gospel that, especially from Pentecost on, would begin to go out across the world. And that was referenced in numerous passages. Matthew 24, verse 14. The gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all the nations. Matthew 28, the Great Commission, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, meaning all people. It doesn't matter what their social status is, their ethnicity, and so forth. They're all the same ultimately, lost. Acts 1:8, another version of the Great Commission, really. Christ tells his disciples right before he ascends to heaven, you'll be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, here, Judea and Samaria, the region, even to the remotest part of the earth. That's another way to say the world. Religious leaders, they're frantic trying to figure out what to do. And John even uses that opportunity to present this ironic prophecy about the gospel, about Christ, the true Christ. What an event this was. I mean, on one hand, all this was going on out there with the people shouting and all they were doing, hailing Jesus as their king. On one hand, they were right. The problem is the wrong kind of king to them. It was for the wrong reasons that they were singing and praising all of that. Therefore, when it became obvious that Jesus was not going to be the political Messiah that they expected, the one that they were designing Jesus to be for them, defining Jesus the way they wanted him to be, when it became apparent over the next few days, leading up to Friday, some of these same people are the voices that, instead of shouting Hosanna, began to scream, "Crucify him," on Friday. The fickle crowd, we don't want that kind of Jesus. What a case of mistaken identity, a dangerous one. There's several dangers, really, that surface from this passage, and I just want to conclude with that today. I could think of three of them. Dangers that are surface here, dangers we should still be aware of. One is the danger of wrong agendas in our world. The biggest concern of people in the crowd, again, just step back and put a label on it, their concern was earthly. And that's what political concerns are about, earthly things. Jesus' agenda was heavenly, eternal. His mission was related to a kingdom, but it's the kingdom of God, not ultimately earthly kingdoms or earthly causes. And we need that reminder frequently because this is a danger. We can easily just get caught up in and focused on the causes of the world. Life here. It seems to be the default setting, really. For most, many at least. Causes related to personal happiness, what'll make me happy. Causes related to money, seeking comfort, and certainly political causes. So we must remember that although many of these things have their place, many of these things are not sinful in and of themselves still, they're just not the most important things. What's important? Are your sins forgiven? That's pretty important. Do you know God? Are you serving the Lord? Are you seeking to please the Lord? Are you a worshiper of God, a follower of Jesus, trusting God? These are the things that are most important. The right agenda, everything else is subservient to that. We just need to keep that perspective. Second, I'm going to broaden it here a little bit compared to your slide there, the danger of, just call it arrogance in general, the danger of arrogance. Now, Jesus is a king, but not a king like any other king. And as we saw, instead of pomp and circumstance, that's what's associated with earthly kings, pomp and circumstance, horses. Now, he rode on the lowly animal. Why? Conveying, as I said, humility, conveying meekness, virtues characteristic of Jesus throughout his earthly ministry. He is the one that said this in Matthew 11, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart." There's that a quote from the Old Testament, "You will find rest for your souls." His first coming, we know something. There's a second coming. He's returning to earth. And at that time, yes, he will be seen to be the powerful, glorious conqueror. He'll be seen to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. There is going to be this one who will come, the Lord coming again, who is going to destroy his enemies. There will be this fierce and final judgment carried out by Jesus. He's each of those. So which model are we to follow today in our earthly lives? And the answer is what he modeled at his first coming. Humility, meekness, sacrifice, gentleness, teachability. Those are the examples we're to follow in all of our relationships, all of our doings, all settings. Let's apply it in our home and our family interactions with one another. Those interactions and the speech ought to be characterized by gentleness and meekness. Humility. All of our business interactions, there's not a separate set of rules there for believers. Still known to be humble, meek, gentle. Relationships with Within the body, other believers ought to be characterized by all of this. Even in our interactions with the people of the world, our interactions with unbelievers, pagans, for the hope of evangelistic opportunities, even the worst of sinners, our interactions ought to be characterized by meekness and humility. I think Richard Phillips captures the point well here. He says, these words, meaning all that's said in this passage really, rebuke us today if we are seeking a militant Savior in Christ. How easy it is for Christians to get so caught up in the so-called culture war. We weren't called to a culture war. The contest today between policies promoting Christian values and those of pagan unbelief, that we mount a war horse to ride against our sinful neighbors. But the Jesus who rode into Jerusalem on a humble donkey would have his followers likewise minister his truth in loving humility. As Christians face an increasingly hostile secular society, we must resist the temptation to wage war, but instead we must represent the Prince of Peace in his truth and love as we interact with unbelieving neighbors, including even such flagrant culture war enemies as abortionists, homosexuals, and evolution proponents. We must reach out to them with the same loving desire for their salvation that drove Jesus into Jerusalem to take up the cross. But I am taking this a step further about leadership. This is what should characterize leaders. Jesus was a king, a humble king. The Jewish religious leaders, they were proud, haughty, and therefore it's the Jewish religious leaders that were harsh and ungracious toward people. So this is a warning against that. So leadership in the home ought to be characterized by humility and meekness and graciousness. Leadership in the church must be characterized by humility and graciousness. Leadership in the business world should be characterized that way. But I want to say also leadership in our nation. It is tragic that some national figures are known for pompous arrogance and haughtiness. That's not God's way. All leaders should follow the example of Christ and be known for humility. You say that, well, that doesn't sound like strong leadership. I'm telling you it is. It's strong leadership. Strong leadership does not have to be ungracious and proud. Strong leadership must not be those things. A third danger, final one, I'm sure there are others, the danger of the broad way. The broad way. We're familiar with the words in the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 7. Christ taught, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who enter it. That most of the world is on the broad way. For the gate is small. The way is narrow that leads to life. There are few, relatively speaking, saved. The true believers in our own nation, they are the extreme minority. It's always been that way. And we see the principle illustrated then in the large crowd of people on that day, the triumphant entry. The shouts of praise, all relating to the terms that they wanted Jesus to fulfill. That's an illustration of the broad way, the wide gate. Redefining Jesus the way you want. The broad way is the way of human understanding. It's the way of human ideas and opinions and preferences and agendas. So yes, Jesus does accept praise. He does want followers. But the bottom line is only on his terms. We can't define the terms. And the terms include the fact that he is not only the Savior, he is the Lord. He is God. He's the Lord who came to save people from their sin. And he is entitled to people's praise and devotion. But on some very narrow terms. Therefore, all people, all methods, all systems, all claims, all perspectives that point people to putting their hope in the things of the world or a wrong definition of Jesus, all of that is just counterfeit. Counterfeits of the true Messiah and his true mission. But the person who comes to embrace the truth, the biblical truth about Jesus, and to follow him alone as their Savior and the Lord of their life is the one then who finds salvation. And not only that, but in this world finds true meaning, true purpose, even for now. And certainly the joy of knowing they have eternal life in heaven someday. Let's pray. Father, as we think more and more this week about what Christ came to do and what he's done for us, Lord, I do pray that you would clear up any confusion in anyone who's here who perhaps has defined Jesus the way they want him to be. Help them understand they can't come to him on their terms, like the crowd so long ago. They are to come humbly embracing Jesus the way he is defined by Scripture, God in human flesh, the one who lived a perfect life in complete obedience to the law of God, the one who willingly gave his life on the cross as a substitute to pay for the sins of all who would follow him, the one who was buried, the one who was raised from the grave to prove that he was God and to prove that his life and sacrifice were accepted. The one who is ruling and reigning over all things today, and the one who will come in power and glory someday. Lord, may you open their hearts to humble themselves to say, I want to trust in this Jesus alone for the forgiveness of my sin and follow him. Help me, Lord, be your follower. For those of us who have professed Christ, Lord, may we never take for granted all that he did for us and is doing for us. May we ponder him frequently, who he is and what he's done. And may we never lose our awe and reverence for that. In our Savior's name, amen. Well, let's sing about this wonderful, wonderful Savior.
We'll just stand together. Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer. Always hunger for.
Please be seated just for a moment or two. Just a few things before we officially close, some very exciting. I want to remind you that this week we do not have our normal Wednesday evening activities, nothing going on here except maybe choir practice. I'm not sure about that part, but instead we have our annual Good Friday service this coming Friday night, a highlight for us as we gather together to sing songs related to that theme, to hear the gospel again, and to observe the Lord's table and remember what the Lord has done for us. So look forward to that. That's at 7 o'clock on Friday evening, but no Wednesday activity. Sunday morning is Resurrection Sunday, commonly known as Easter Sunday, of course, but we make just a little bit of change in our schedule. We'll have our normal services, but there are going to be no Sunday school class for the adults, nor for the middle school students, nor for the young adults in Resolved. So those classes will not take place. Children's classes will, but you just need to be aware of that. But that'll be a great day as we just celebrate the resurrection of the Lord from the grave and his life today. There are other things coming up. Pay a close attention to pancake breakfast. Do I need to say anything more about that? I mean, I should have you at the word pancake, okay, and breakfast, those two together. So, I mean, look at that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. There's at least 8 there. That's a short stack. And we got bigger ones, too, I'm sure. But anyway, come. It's for our ministry to our students and so forth. So it's just a wonderful time of fellowship as well. Consider coming to that super seminar. It's going to be a great time with Dale Johnson here on the Friday night, Saturday morning. It's in April. But it just helping us understand more of what it means to have a culture of care in our church, how we minister to one another, men's conference, you already know about that, and so forth. Do want to remind you, though, of the special reception for Pastor Rafael Salazar, who's coming April 7th. That Sunday, Rafael, as you know, has preached here before. He's a pastor down in Honduras, and he went through the training in Honduras as well. That we help sponsor Ruth and Fabio Gomez move there. As you know, they're members of that church. But Pastor Rafael is going to be here in that afternoon in a reception. If you'd like to hear more about a ministry that church has in Honduras as they minister to some folks that are extremely poor and needy in an area south of their city. And so there'll just be a reception. You can get some information about that ministry if you'd like to hear about that. Other things to look at, but so exciting we get to welcome new members into our church body today. 12 new members into our body. So there were 3 couples that we welcomed in. The first service, we'll do 3 this service, but the 3 that were welcomed the first service, you have their pictures, of course, but we welcomed in Mark and Kelly Lyerly into our church body. Hunter, his folks, but they've been coming for a while and plugged in, so we're so glad to have Mark and Kelly Lyerly. Gary and Crystal Yarbrough have finished the membership process and joined our church. So glad to have them. And then Ronnie and Noreen Bricky, also are official members of our church now. I have a special relationship with them, most of you know. They're the parents of my daughter-in-law, Brittany, who married my son. So we get a lot of interaction with them, and we certainly enjoy that. But all these folks, Mark and Kelly Lyerly, the Yarbroughs and the Brickies, if you see them, introduce yourself to them. Welcome into our church body. But today in this service, we get to have some come down front so you can see them here. And first, Bob and Diane Boylan. Bob and Diane are here, moved here from the Portland area recently. We're so glad that the Lord has brought them our way, Bob and Diane Boylan. I don't know where everybody is, but just slide over just in case, over to this side over here, Bob and Diane. You'll still sing the song that you guys prepared, but just stay right there for right now. Julian and Noel Cotulier are here. So glad the Lord brought them our way as well. And then David and Barbara Kirk, there they are. All right, all worked out. So just right over here on this side. And everybody, good look at all these new folks. And again, when you see them around, introduce yourself to them, welcome them. So we have Bob and Diane Boylan, Julian and Noel Cotulier, and we have David and Barbara Kirk right down here. So glad to have you guys. So you can be seated, and we want to pray for you, though, as we dismiss today. Sure, there are other things in the bulletin I need to call attention to, but that's the main stuff. So let's pray and ask the Lord's blessings. You stand. Father, we thank you for the folks that you bring our way by your providence to plug in and connect with Twin City to commit to this church to be their church family. We're so thankful for that, and we give you the praise and glory for it. We thank you for all these children that sang today. What an exciting thing to think about the generations to come that we're impacting with the gospel and what ministry looks like and all of that. So thank you for that great privilege. But I pray for these new members that you would encourage them, bless them, give them many great relationships, ministry opportunities. Help us as a church family to fulfill our responsibility to them as well. But we commit them and ourselves into your hands in Christ's name. Amen. If you're visiting here today, so glad you're here. Hope I can meet you out in the lobby.